Hi everybody, I'm Mike from the Marion Natural History Museum, and today we're going to learn how to put together our Apogee Apprentice rocket kit. We're going to go from this to this. Let's get started. Go ahead and take the package for your rocket kit and cut open the bag and empty all the parts out onto your workspace. Make sure that we have in your pack all of the pieces that you see laid out here for me. One thing to note when you're looking for all of these pieces is that sometimes some of the parts will get stuck inside of each other during packing or shipping. For instance, you might find that the nose cone and its end cap will be already stuck together, so those will be separated, we'll be gluing those together. You will also sometimes find that the smaller spacer ring will be stuck inside the motor tube. So if you don't see your spacer rings, check inside the various tubes that come with the kit, because sometimes those spacers will slip inside there. But otherwise, you should have all the parts that you see laid out here. So what we've got is we have our main body tube. This is the body of the rocket itself. We have a smaller motor mount tube, this white cardboard tube. This is what will hold the rocket motor in place. We have two pieces for our nose cone, an end cap and the nose cone itself. We have our plastic fin can. We have a motor retention clip, a small metal motor retention clip. A very small and easy to miss launch lug. This goes down over the launch rod when the rocket is waiting on the pad and helps to make sure the rocket is upright during the initial part of flight, during takeoff. We have two green spacer rings, cardboard spacer rings, and one smaller blue spacer ring. We've got a pack with the parachute and the rip prevention rings for the parachute, along with some shock cords for the parachute. We have our main shock cord for the nose cone and the parachutes and the rocket body. There's a sticker pack so you can decorate your rocket, and there's also the paper instructions that I'll be using to guide us through the lesson, and I'll let everybody know what step we're on as we move through construction of the rocket. As far as supplies that you'll need, you will want to have handy a little bit of masking tape, roll of masking tape, some white school glue, some super glue will be handy as we're putting our rocket together. Pair of scissors, pencil, an X-Acto knife, or a box cutter or other razor blade, and a ruler will be also very handy as we're going through the lesson. You'll also want to keep a couple paper towels on hand, because as we're working with the glue, we'll probably get it all over our fingers and you'll need to wipe it off, with the exception, of course, of our super glue. If you are a younger student and you're tackling this project on your own and you have the super glue handy, we've got to be very careful with this. It might be a great idea to have an adult help you when it comes time to work with either the super glue or your X-Acto knife. The X-Acto knife, of course, is very sharp and can be dangerous, and the super glue will glue anything, including bonding skin. So we've got to be very careful when working with our super glue. Okay, so to get started, flip open our instructions. We're going to start with step one, good place to start. And that just requires that we put the two pieces of our nose cone together. So the nose cone comes as these two separate parts. We're going to glue the end cap into the nose cone itself, and for that we can use our super glue. So I'm going to open up my super glue container here and just spread a thin bit of super glue around the inside edge of our nose cone. I'll just rotate this around. Down. Super glue dries pretty quickly, so you have to act kind of fast when you're working with it. And once you've got the glue spread around the inside edge, go ahead and insert your end cap into the nose cone, and then you can set that aside to dry. It'll bond in just a few minutes, but we won't be needing the nose cone straight away, so let's just set that aside. Okay, next up we're going to be working on our motor mount tube for our rocket motor. What we need to do is we need to affix our motor retention clip to the rocket's motor tube. We're going to do that by slicing a thin slice into the motor tube up here, That's going to be wide enough for the retention clip to slip into, and then we're going to adhere the retention clip to the tube with some masking tape. So, according to our instructions, what we need to do is we're going to measure 2 1/4 inches from the end of our motor mount tube and mark a spot 2 1/4 inches up. So that's here, according to my measurements. So we're going to mark 2 1/4 inches from the end of the tube. We're just going to draw a little pencil line here just to mark it so we know where to cut with our X-Acto knife. And here comes our first bit of delicate cutting. Move some of these pieces out of the way. We need to cut a space through the motor tube that is just long enough, or just wide enough rather, for our retention clip to fall through. So I'm gonna start by scoring, just by dragging across the motor mount tube. A little bit of a line, and it won't take long before you've cut through that outer layer of the motor tube, and then you can press your X-Acto knife straight through that mark that we created. It doesn't have to be wide, it's only 1/8 of an inch. It just has to be wide enough for us to be able to press the motor retention clip through the wall of the motor mount tube, like so. When you look down the tube, you'll be able to see the tip of the clip right through there. It's going right through the wall. And now what we'll do is we'll grab our masking tape and we will wrap that around the middle portion of our motor retention clip here as it sits on the tube. So I will grab just a short length of masking tape. And holding our retention clip straight up and down the tube, I can lay a piece of tape across the center of it here, and then roll my bit of tape around the tube. Great. So what we've got now is the retention clip is in place, and as you'll see when we get close to the end of rocket construction, this clip will be able to move out of the way just enough to let the motor fall into the tube and then spring back into place and prevent the motor from falling out of the rocket's tube. Okay, excellent. So now what we're going to do is we're going to start working with our spacers. The small blue spacer goes into the top of the motor retention tube. This is the bottom where the clip sticks way off the end. This is the end that the rocket's motor gets slipped into, so this is the back end of the rocket. This is the front end of the motor retention tube, and we're going to take our little blue spacer, and it's going to get glued into the top of the motor tube. So what we need to do is we're going to get our school glue, our white Elmer's glue. We're going to spread that around the inside edge of the motor tube, and then we'll press our spacer all the way down until it touches the front of the clip there that we've pressed through the wall of the tube. So I'll get my glue. Hopefully my glue is still liquid. Looks like it is. That's great. Open up my glue here. And we're going to take the glue and spread it around the inside edge of the motor tube. There we go. So all the way around the inside edge of the tube. Let's see if we can get that up there so you can see that. And then we'll take our blue spacer and we'll just drop that into the top of the tube. I'm going to twist just a little bit to get a good amount of glue all the way around the edge of that spacer. As I press down into the tube, it should slide down, and once it touches the metal clip, you've pressed it in far enough. Mine goes down just a little bit more than 1/8 of an inch, so not too far. Okay. Great. So we'll set our motor tube aside for 1 second. Now what we're going to do is we're going to work with, we're on step number 4 at this point. We've completed steps 1, 2, and 3. We're going to take one of our green spacers and this has to slip over the end of the motor mount tube. If I grab the tube, it's going to go over the end, so it'll start slipping over the clip that extends off the end of the tube, and it's going to fit over the end of the motor mount. This spacer here is going to make sure that when we assemble it into the fin can, that it sits centered inside the fin can for the rocket. It normally slips really easily over the motor mount tube, but now that we've added the clip, the fit is going to be a little bit tighter. You might find that you benefit from running the fingernail from your thumb around the inside edge of the spacer. That's going to just open up this facing of the spacer just a little bit and might make it a little bit easier to slip onto the end of the motor mount tube. There we go. Like so. Now one thing we are going to have to do is, because of the way that this is going to slip onto the end of the tube, you can see here that our spacer is going to further constrain the motor clip. This is really not quite enough travel for the clip in order to easily get our motor in. Now in the past when I've taught this course, I found that it's not strictly necessary to perform the step of relieving this strain. The motor mount clip will work just fine if you find that your fit is snug and you don't want to go through the next step of working with the X-Acto knife. There won't be any detrimental effect to the rocket at all. However, the instructions suggest that what we do is we trim off the eighth of an inch portion of the spacer ring that is going to cover the clip, thus freeing the clip back up so that it's only constrained by the masking tape right here. Again, this, I would say that this step is optional, but because the instructions call for it and we're good instruction followers, I'm going to try working with my X-Acto knife and cutting a 1/8 of an inch section of my spacer ring away. Again, be really careful working with an X-Acto knife. It's really sharp. Just cut this portion away. A little bit of a sawing motion seems to be working pretty well for me. Although I don't want to mar my workspace, so I'm going to flip this guy over and finish my cut from the other side. Okay, I'm through there. Some gentle pressure here. Looks like I should be able to come through on this side too. Okay. So now I've got that little bit of the spacer ring cut away. Set aside the X-Acto knife, and that would mean that we'd be able to put this spacer ring on and not pin the motor retention clip. So if we've got that squared away, the next step is to apply some glue around the perimeter of our motor tube. And then I can take my spacer and slip it down over and on top of that glue there and adjust it so that my retention clip for the motor falls nicely right between the two cut ends of that ring. Make your spacer flush with the end of the motor mount tube so it doesn't go too far up. It's not hanging off the end of it, it's just nice and flush with it. And we've got a little bead of glue right there, which will be nice for strengthening that. Okay. So, next step, step number 5. We're going to take this entire assembly and we're going to glue it into the fin can itself. As we put the motor mount tube into the fin can, The instructions call for us to advance the motor mount tube all the way up into the bottom of the fin can enough that this back edge is flush with the back edge of the fin can. That requires that our motor mount tube stick up through the top of the fin can a little bit, but you'll see that in my case, I've got some plastic burrs from the molding process that are preventing my motor mount tube from easily slipping up through the front here. We don't want to apply so much pressure that we're going to dislodge our back end spacer ring here, because we did just try to glue it in place and it's still drying. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to see if with just my fingernail I can either remove some of these plastic burrs easily enough. They're pretty thick though. So what I think we're going to have to do is we may have to trim some of that excess plastic away with our X-Acto knife. Again, this is something that you'll either want to do with adult supervision or just be very, very careful with. The front edge of our X-Acto knife just running along that interior ring of our fin can here. We can shave those burrs down, and that should make it a whole lot easier for our motor mount tube to advance through the front here. Just trying to get a flat, smooth edge here. Okay, I think we're in pretty good shape. Let's see. Grab my motor mount tube. Again, moving it up through the back end of the fin can, and we should be able to see this advance up through the front of the tube, or through the front of the fin can, just like so. Now again, be careful pressing this in the back here. In fact, until we actually have our glue back here, you don't want to advance this all the way up. And instead of trying to pull the motor mount tube back out, press the front edge of the motor mount tube until the tube pops out of the fin can. So now what we're going to do is we will apply some glue to the inside edge of our fin can's back end here, and then we'll push our motor mount tube up into the front again. This is step 5. Now in the past I've done this successfully both with white Elmer's glue and with super glue. I'm going to try the super glue this time because I know we'll get a nice tight bond there. So give my super glue a little bit of a squeeze here until I get back around to the front end of that bead that I had started. Okay, now we're going to take our tube and stick it up into the fin can. Make sure that you push the motor mount tube flush with the end of your fin can, and it would be great if your clip is between two fins right here. It's actually okay if it ends up aligned with a fin, but it will make it a little bit easier to handle and insert your motor if you advance it into the fin can and place that clip between two fins. That should mean at the front end, our motor mount tube is sticking out, and the back end, our motor mount tube is nice and flush. Okay. Next up, we're going to take our remaining spacer ring and we're going to cap the front end of the motor mount tube like so. Mine's slipped on really easily, but again, if you need a little bit more relief, you can run your thumbnail around the inside edge of that spacer ring, and that should create a nice smooth edge and make it really easy to slip on. And I'm going to grab my white glue. If I can get it to come out, there we go. I'm just going to run a bead around the front end of the motor mount tube. I'll take my spacer ring and insert it over, and I'm going to give it a little bit of a twist as I insert it on, and that'll hopefully make sure that my glue is nicely evenly distributed as I put it onto the motor mount tube. There we go. Nice and flush with the front end. Pretty flush with the front end of the fin can, and a nice bead of glue that's just visible as it meets the front of the fin can. If you find that you're getting lots of glue that's squeezing out between the fin can and the spacer ring, go ahead and grab one of your paper towels and just clean up that edge. This is the end that's going to ultimately go into the rocket's body tube, So we need to make sure that it's clean enough on the front end here that it'll slip into the body tube easily enough. Okay. So that was step six. I'm going to take my fin can with the motor mount tube inside of it and just set it aside so that it can glue, or dry rather, for the next little bit. And we're going to switch to handling our body tube. So the body tube of the rocket needs to have affixed to it our launch lug. This launch lug will be glued to the body tube in such a way that when we put our rocket on the launch pad, the steel launch rod is going to stick up through this launch lug and hold the rocket in position until the motor ignites and it has enough speed that the fin cannon can actually take over and make sure that the rocket flies straight. But this will hold the rocket pointed up to the sky until that happens. So what we need to do is we're going to measure 1.5 inches from the bottom end of the body tube. Either end can be the back end of the body tube. It's identical in both directions right now. So we'll measure 1.5 inches from one end of the body tube and place the launch lug that distance away from the end of the tube. We're going to glue it, and we want to make sure that we're gluing it straight up and down. It does need to be pretty straight along the axis of the body tube. The instructions have a couple bits of advice for how to get a nice straight edge there, one of which is to use a door jamb. If you take the body tube and you press it up against the edge of a doorway, that'll give you a nice straight edge all the way up and down the doorway, and then you'll be able to mark your line for the launch lug starting at 1.5 inches from the bottom and all the way up the body tube, just long enough so that you can actually get a good gauge of where to glue your launch lug. So I'm going to do that now, and when I restart the video, we should have a really faint line from our pencil that we can lay our launch lug against. Okay, I'm back from my door jam, and I've taken the pencil and etched a line along the edge of our body tube here. It's difficult to see the actual graphite from the pencil, but you can see the line that the pencil made as an indentation along the outside finish of the body tube right there, just passing through our reflection right there now. So that's my guideline that I'm going to glue the launch lug against, and I'm going to measure 1.5 inches up from the bottom end of the body tube, and that will be where the bottom end of the launch lug will start. So this should be a pretty easy mark to make. So 1.5 inches is, there's my 1 inch, there's my 1.5 inches, and I'll make a mark on my body tube that I can just see with help of my light source that's behind me. Probably pretty difficult for me to capture in the camera here, but just as long as you've made that mark 1.5 inches up from the end of the body tube, there you can just see it just now. That's where the bottom end of the launch lug is going to go. So my launch lug will rest along my first line, starting at the 1.5 inch mark here. So to do this, we need to again grab our weight glue. I'll do a little short line like this, not quite as long as the launch lug. And I can take my launch lug and nestle it into that glue. I'll line up with my 1.5 inch mark at the bottom there, and I'm eyeballing whether or not it falls along that pencil line that I made using the door jam. The launch lug is really lightweight, so the glue should have enough surface tension on its own to hold it in place. But what I would recommend is that when possible, store the drying launch lug and body tube in an upright position. If you lay it on the side of the table, you know, on its side on the table surface, it's likely that the tube is going to roll and press against the launch lug, and it may become dislodged or it might dry in a crooked direction. So make sure that when you're able, you can store this standing straight up and down so that we get a nice straight dry edge on that. Okay. Next, we are still going to be working with the body tube, but we want to get our fin can glued into the bottom edge of the body tube. There come some times when we're working with our model kit that some pieces that are still drying need to continue to be worked with. For instance, when we were working with our motor mount tube and putting it up into the fin can, there were still some pieces that were drawing on this, but they weren't so prone to disruption or being disturbed that we had to worry too much about it. As we are now going to mate our fin can with our body tube and launch lug, this is one of those times when we want to make sure that as we're handling our body tube, we don't accidentally press on the launch lug and dislodge it while it's drying. So, that in mind, what we'll need to do is we'll be putting some glue along the inside edge of our body tube here, and then press fitting our fin can in. It's a good idea to start with a dry fit, just to make sure that your fin can fits into the body tube easily enough and we don't run into a problem while there's glue on the surface. Another thing to keep in mind is, as we're putting these two pieces together, you're going to need to align the launch lug in such a way that it falls between two fins. This launch lug is where that launch rod is going to fit, and if the launch lug is aligned either with or too closely against a fin, you'll find that it's either impossible to get it onto the launch rod or that there's extra friction when the rocket is trying to launch. So make sure that that launch lug falls nicely, well clear of any two fins on our fin can here. It's probably also a good idea to see if you can get it separate from the rocket motor clip at the bottom here. So if your clip falls between two fins, make sure that you get your launch lug between two different fins as you're putting it together. Okay, so bearing that in mind, I'll put my fin can down, and we're gonna run some glue along the inside of the body tube here. Again, being careful of that launch lug. I'm gonna try and make sure that my grip is clear of that launch lug as I'm spinning this around. And we'll get some glue on the inside edge of our body tube. And when we're putting our fin can in, that fin can leading spacer and then the plastic part of the fin can itself is certainly going to smear that glue around on the inside edge there, so it should get nice even distribution. So picking up my fin can, I'm going to take my body tube, and again, that launch lug wanting to fit between two fins on our fin can, I'm going to take my body tube and fin can and mate them together. I'm going to give it a little bit of a twist just to make sure that we get some nice even glue distribution on there. And now with my launch lug falling definitely between those two fins, I'm gonna set this guy aside to dry. Again, we wanna make sure that we don't accidentally press on the launch lug as it's drying. Not too much danger of that now that the fin can is in place, but you will also find that there is a little bit of play twisting wise between the fin can and the body tube. So resting it on its side like this may mean that the rocket kit is going to sag and your body tube will be slightly misaligned with the fin can. So my best advice would be to try to dry the rocket upright like so. It should balance just fine, but if you can store it or let it dry upright and make sure that your fin can is nice and straight, this should mean that the rocket is straight as an arrow when the glue finally dries. I'm going to stop my video now and let my rocket kit dry a little bit longer before we go back into working with some of the parts. All right, for step number 9, we're going to start working on some pieces of the parachute. So I've got my little parachute kit here. I've got my Kevlar shock cord right here, this string that's tied up. And then we're also going to need a piece of our instruction sheet. On the front end of the instruction sheet, there's this little trapezoid right here. It says this paper shock cord anchor is used in step 9 on page 3. So we're actually going to cut this trapezoid piece out from our instructions. On the other side is step number 4, and we've already completed that step, so we don't actually need this side of our instruction sheet any longer. So I will open this up, grab my scissors, and then we'll be able to cut this shape with these two dotted lines vertically on it and the Apogee Components logo right here. We're gonna cut this shape out. Okay. Done some bulk cutting, so now I can do my little bit of detail right here. Trim off that end. Trim off this end, and what we're left with is just this piece of paper. Now this is going to act as our shock cord anchor. The instructions on step number 9 call for us to take some glue, smear it along the inside edge of this, and then lay a piece of our shock, one end of our shock cord along it. We're then going to fold this into thirds, so the paper is actually going to bind the shock cord inside of it and glue to itself. And then this whole assembly gets glued inside the front end of our rocket body tube and acts as the connector piece between our body tube and the motor mount and fin can and the nose cone and the attached parachute when the ejection charge actually fires during flight. So I'm going to need to undo my bit of shock cord here. Extend one end of my shock cord away so that I'm just left with one end of the shock cord. We'll do a zigzag glue pattern across this trapezoid, and we'll lay our shock cord diagonally across it. Diagonally will at least make sure that as we're folding this into thirds that the net effect is that the shock cord kind of zigzags back and forth across the inside of the shock cord anchor. All right. So actually it'll be a whole lot easier for us to actually glue it to this side where we can see our dotted lines. So let's do that. I'm going to take some white glue and drawing it in a zigzag pattern. I'm just going to run some glue down the face of this piece of paper. And then starting from our narrow end of the trapezoid, I'll lay my shock cord into that glue. Just give it a little wiggle back and forth to make sure that the glue gets onto that shock cord anchor. And now what we're going to do is we're going to take this end that has the end of the shock cord, and we're going to fold it up to the middle here. A little challenging considering that now it's got glue on the surface, but we got to get it up off of our work surface and press our paper down like so. If you press too hard, you're just going to get glue everywhere. So it doesn't have to be smushed flat, but we do want to fold it on that dotted line that we saw, and then we can get this up off of our work surface and fold it over again like so. And now we've got this piece of paper that's been folded into thirds with our shock cord line sticking out of the end of it. And it should be nicely bound up and glued inside of this piece. Okay. This is ultimately going to go into our body tube, which is step number 10. So we'll be applying some glue to one side of this shock cord anchor and then pressing that inside our body tube. This is, again, one of those steps where we have some pieces of the rocket that are already drying, so it might be a wise idea to put all of the parts aside for maybe 10 minutes or so, give the glue some time to set up and dry just a little bit so that we're not working with wet glue and able to dislodge pieces, and then come back to actually insert this into the body tube. So that's what I'm going to do. Once that shock cord anchor has had time to dry, and similarly our launch lug on the body tube has had a little bit of time to dry as well, we can take the shock cord anchor and move to the next step of gluing this inside the body tube. This is step number 10 in our rocket kit instructions. In order for all of the pieces, the remaining pieces of the rocket, like the parachute and shock cords and nose cone, to be able to fit into the front end of the body tube, this shock cord anchor has to be placed at least 1.25 inches down into the body tube. If you've got big fingers, this might be a difficult task. Certainly people who have smaller fingers and longer fingers will have an easier time of actually making sure that the shock cord anchor gets as deep down into the body tube as possible. So let's take that next step. We're going to apply some glue to the edge or the facing of our shock cord anchor. and then we'll put it on our fingertip and hopefully guide it down the body tube far enough, an inch and a quarter at least, down into the body tube, and glue it to the inside edge, the inside face of our tube. So I'm going to apply a little bit of glue to my shock cord anchor. I did a little zigzag back and forth. I'm sure that we'll get that glue to spread out evenly across that shock cord anchor once it's inside the body tube. And now, carefully lifting the body tube, because I'm sure there are still some drying pieces on this kit, I'm going to take this and usher it down into the tube, at least an inch and a quarter, and hopefully a little bit farther. And then I'm going to press it on the inside wall of the tube. I believe mine is somewhere down around here, so I'm probably two and a quarter inches down the body tube, which would be great because that's going to give me a little bit of extra space for the nose cone once it gets inserted inside, and the parachute, which gets stored inside the body tube as well. Got some glue on my finger, so paper towels come in handy for this part. And that will hopefully dry in place. Let's see if we can get a look down the body tube. It's going to be kind of hard to see down there. But our won't be able to see that easily enough because it's pretty dark down there. But if we've, as long as we've got an inch and a quarter down inside the body tube and glued to the inside wall there, we should be okay. Our next step, step number 11, is to take the other end of our shock cord. We have to tie this end to the loop here in our nose cone end cap. For that, we'll be able to slip our shock cord through, pull through on this side, and then we're going to tie a knot here to make sure that the shock cord is tied nice and tight to the end of our nose cone cap. So let's take a couple seconds and do that. If you find that your end of the shock cord is really badly frayed, you know, lots of fibers spreading out, making it difficult to get through this loop, you can always just trim off a little bit with your scissors and then pass it through this loop and then set up a knot on the other side. Now what we'll do is, it doesn't require a complex knot. If you don't know any specialized knots or anything like that, you can tie several of them, and then we're going to apply a dab of glue to the knots to make sure that they don't come undone. So we'll take a second. I'm going to give myself a little bit of extra here. The shock cord is really quite long, so you can be pretty generous with the amount of shock cord that you're using to make your knot. It's not necessary to keep it, you know, super long or, you know, to be afraid of using too much shock cord when putting your knots together. Once I've got mine through, I'm just going to tie it again onto itself. That is, if I can manipulate my end of the shock cord. It's fighting me a little bit. There we go. I'll be able to tighten this. And now that I've got my knot in place, I can apply a little dab of either white glue or super glue to my knot. Hoping to be able to get that focus. There we go. So my little knot, I'll just apply some glue to this guy, and that should make sure that that never lets go once the rocket is launched several times. Pull that tight. I'm gonna get a little bit of super glue and just apply a little dab of that. All right, so that should set up nicely in a couple seconds. Cover my super glue. And then after I'm confident that that's dried, I'll probably trim off this excess piece of shock cord right here, just so that it doesn't get in my way in the future as we're trying to pack the rocket and put this nose cone back inside, preparing for launch. Okay. So this is another one of those pieces that can just be set aside. We should have now a rocket with fin can, body tube, launch lug, an assembled nose cone with its end cap, and all of this connected together by a shock cord that goes to the shock cord anchor that we just glued inside the body tube. So I'll take this entire assembly and set it aside, let it continue to dry, and we'll move on to assembling our parachute. So parachute and all of its pieces come in this little package that I'm going to carefully open with scissors. Be careful as you're opening it. There are bits of string in here that are for the parachute. You want to make sure that you're not accidentally cutting those in half as you're snipping open the bag. So just be careful of that. And then once you get the bag open, you can pour the contents out, and we'll go through what's in here. We've got a folded plastic parachute, all one big plastic sheet. We've got the parachute lines. These are actually three separate bits of string taped together. And then we've got these little paper or plastic rings that are like rip stops for the parachute. They'll make sure that as we string the parachute line through the holes in the parachute here, that the string doesn't just rip through the plastic of our parachute. Okay, so the first step, I'm going to set aside the rip stops and the string. We are going to take our parachute and we're going to cut it out. The parachute has a number of dashed lines all the way around its perimeter. The same parachute template can be used for a variety of different rocket kits, but our rocket is large enough that we want to use as much of the parachute as we can, so we're going to cut out the full hexagon shape that we have here on the outside perimeter. So don't cut the circle here. Don't cut the inside circle. You've got to cut this hexagon pattern all the way out. So I'll grab my scissors and we'll start with that. Just cut along that dotted line around our outside hexagon perimeter. It's okay to pull those pieces off if they're getting in your way once you've made a good long cut. Hexagon pattern parachute cut out. And what we're going to do is we'll use the pencil to just poke holes through the center of these circles here, right through the center dotted circle. That's where we'll pass the strings through, and then the ripstop stickers that we have will go right around the outside perimeter there. So let's grab our pencil and we can poke holes through those middle circles there, just giving our string enough space to pass through. If you're not confident that you can get the pencil through the center of your plastic without ripping the rest of the parachute, it's okay to apply the ripstop stickers first and then poke holes with your pencil following that. Going around and poking holes through those center circles just to give myself enough room to pass that string through. That's number six. Yep. Okay. And then I'm going to grab my ripstop stickers and apply those to each of my circles here. And this will make sure that as the parachute deploys and the strings are giving a little bit of a pull on the parachute, that the fragile plastic of the parachute isn't ripped by those parachute shrouds. Because the plastic is really lightweight and the strings are relatively strong, if these ripstops were not in place, it's possible that all the yanking and tugging that the rocket body could do during its descent back to the ground could pull the string straight through the outside edge of our parachute. And these will prevent that. Okay, so now we've got our rip stops applied all the way around our perimeter. Now we've got to take the tape off of our parachute shroud here. This is either going to be something that we can pull off, or you may find that you have to go at this with some scissors, but if you go that route, you'll want to be very careful and make sure that you don't accidentally trim any of the parachute shroud. So I've managed to peel my tape apart with just my fingers. I'll remove that. All right. A couple of seconds ago, or a few minutes ago, I said that this was three separate parachute shrouds. It's not. It's a single piece. So this actually requires we take our single piece and turn it into three pieces. To do that, we're going to take our parachute shroud and we're going to arrange it in sort of a zigzag pattern. It'd naturally be very easy for us to cut this in half. We would ordinarily take our two ends, put them together, and see where they meet at the very bottom, and we would trim that. We can use the same idea by turning this into a zigzag pattern that goes back, forth, and back again. So what I'll have on one end, if we can see with my camera field of view here, is we'll have one end and a loop, and then if I go to the other side, at the other end of this line, we should have the end of our string and another loop. This is illustrated in step number 12 in our instruction sheet. You'll see they indicate the shroud line right here, going back and forth and back again. So that gets us one, two, three equal lengths of parachute shroud, and we trim these two ends. And then that turns into our three parachute shroud lines. So, again, setting up that zigzag pattern, I will grab my two ends. Get my parachute out of the way for a second, get my workspace clear here. Great. Now, do these have to be 100% equal length? No, definitely not. We want to get close enough. We don't want them to be completely off from each other, but a few centimeters difference here and there is not going to make too much of a difference. So, with one end arranged like so, I'm going to cut this loop, and then that should let me pull this other end all the way through, and that should mean when I get to the end here, these are about equal length. See if I can untangle that for illustration purposes. These are pretty much the same length. They're really, really close. So I'm just going to take this end and trim like that. So now we should have three parachute shroud lines. If you want them to be exact lengths, you can trim off a little bit of excess right here. And then check your other end and even those guys up. These look pretty equal. But close enough is just fine for our purposes here. So now, bringing our parachute back into the picture, what we're going to do is we have to take these three shroud lines and we have to connect them to adjacent edges of our parachute, like so. So I've got one side of my hexagon here and I'm going to attach this line and this line here. And then similarly, I will take the next shroud line and I will find my next two adjacent and empty holes on my parachute and attach shroud lines here and here. And the same is true for the other end of our parachute over here. This will take a couple of seconds because we're working with a tiny bit of string and a really tiny hole on the parachute and having to tie knots at the ends of these. So I'm gonna do that, but I will probably speed up the video, or you can advance to the point where I've actually got these guys all done, or it might take you an equal amount of time that it takes me in order to get these strung together. This does require a little bit of patience and a little bit of time. Pull those tight, and now I've got one side of my parachute strung together. Make sure that as you're going around the perimeter of your parachute, you're not accidentally tying a shroud line to the same location that another shroud is already tied. We have 6 points here, 3 shrouds, so we have 6 ends altogether, so there won't be any doubling up of shroud lines. You'll move to the next 2 empty shroud or empty parachute holes and tie your shroud lines into that. If your hole is not quite clear enough, you could always poke your pencil back through it. Now that those rip stops are in place, we shouldn't have to worry too much about ripping the parachute while we widen our holes. That should be okay. Two holes in our parachute will be mated with the last shroud that we have, the last length of string. If for any reason you do find that the cutting process was challenging, or you've got really different lengths of shroud line and you're not happy with the way that it came out, there's nothing terribly special about these shroud lines. It's just string. So if you've got a little bit of twine in the house, it'll work just fine as a replacement. There we go, there's one. My last hole. So now our completed parachute with its attached shrouds should look something like this. We've got each of our lines is attached to the two holes on any end of our hexagon here. Okay, so now what we'll do is we're going to attach this to the rocket itself. I'm going to flip this over and I'll take my 3 shroud lines and I'm going to collect them together, like so. So now what I've got here is on the bottom side of my parachute, I've got these 3 shroud lines together. I can flip my parachute a little bit and grab the center circle of my parachute. And if I give just gentle tugs and try and even these shrouds out, we should get something that looks like this. Here I am catching one end of the parachute here, or the center of the parachute, and then pulling on all 3 of my shroud lines together. And you can see that I've got all 3 shroud loop ends around my finger. 1, 2, 3. So what we'll do now is we're going to take this loop of our 3 shroud lines and we're going to pass it through the loop on the end of our nose cone. I'm going to grab my nose cone here. These 3 loops together are going to pass through this loop on the end of the nose cone, and then we will use the loop here to tie the parachute onto the nose cone. So, like this. I'm going to tighten up those 3 loop ends just a little bit, and I can pass them through the loop on the end of the nose cone. Like so. There's those 3. They just passed straight through. I did have to tighten them up pretty nicely. And making sure that you still have 3 loops, right? We don't want to accidentally isolate, you know, one end of a shroud against its partners. We want to make sure that we still have 3 loop ends here. I'm going to pull that through a little bit more and a little bit more until I've got a really, really wide mouth on my loop here. And grabbing that center of the parachute, I'm just going to take this entire parachute and pass it through the three loops that we have. Pull the whole parachute through the three loops. Don't fight it and don't tug too much. But once that parachute has passed through those three loop ends, we should find that we can give a little bit of a gentle pull and the three loops tighten up against themselves back here on the end of the nose cone cap. So now the entire parachute assembly and the shock cord are all tied to the end of the nose cone. Awesome. Okay. This now means actually that the entire rocket has been completely assembled. What we need to do now is we need to talk about preparing the rocket for flight. So all of our rocket pieces are now tied together into one kit. Getting the parachute and the shroud lines together inside the rocket in such a way that they'll deploy successfully at the middle of our flight is important. So if you refer to page 5 of your instructions, they actually have a diagram, which I'll put in front of the camera now. They have a diagram here on page 5 of the best way to fold and pack your parachute. Can be a little bit of a process, but we want to get the parachute as flat out as we can so we can fold our hexagon in half. Fold that in half again. You'll notice this is that short bottom end of the hexagon shape of our parachute. Fold that in half. And then fold all the sides together so that what you'll find is we've created this triangle where all 6 points of our shroud lines are together at the very bottom of this triangle. We fold that in half again. And then we lay our excess shroud across the parachute's body. We fold that triangle over the shroud lines, fold the tip of the triangle down over that, and then we roll this pretty tightly. It has to be rolled tightly enough that it's going to fall easily into the body tube of the rocket. If you find that as you're stuffing your parachute into the body tube of the rocket that you're really having to stuff it in there with your fingers, then it's going to be too tight to deploy successfully when the rocket hits the top of its flight. So we want to make sure that it's rolled tightly enough that it slides into the rocket tube and can slide out easily enough. We don't want to fight too much with that, otherwise that means that it's too tight. So, bearing all that in mind, I'm going to take my rocket body and move it over here. Get myself a little bit of clear space in my work area. Okay. Now we're going to fold our parachute in half. What we'll have is one of our shrouds here at this corner, one of our shrouds at this corner, and then the other 4 shrouds down here at the bottom edge, like so. We're going to fold that in half again. Like so. And then we're going to fold those pieces together like so. So what you'll end up with, mine's a bit imprecise, but that's okay. What we're going to end up with is all of our shroud points, all of our connecting points of our shroud together at the bottom of our shape. We can fold these pieces together, and then we'll take all of our excess parts of our shroud line. I'm going to grab maybe from my midpoint right here and just lay them gently into this trough that I'm creating, or this little cradle I'm creating with our parachute plastic. We can roll that together. We can fold our top half over, and then we can roll this a little bit tighter together. What we should end up with is a bundle of parachute that is narrow enough to be able to slide into the body tube of our rocket. So I'm going to give a test fit right here. This is a technique that's worth perfecting because so often we have rockets that take off from the pad, get all the way up to the apogee of their flight, the ejection charge fires, and nothing happens because the parachute was packed way too tightly. So this should slide really easily into the body tube. We shouldn't have to force it down with our finger. It should slide super easy into the body tube. If it doesn't, you may want to take your parachute out and check to make sure that you can't just roll it up a tiny bit tighter to get it into the body tube. At the same time, we have to take all the rest of the shock cord and we have to get it into the body tube as well in order for this to be packed properly. And then our nose cone will be the finishing piece that goes right into the top of the body tube. Make sure that as you're inserting your nose cone, that you're not pinching extra pieces of the shock cord or of the parachute, that nothing is pinching here at the top of the body tube, that instead it's just the nose cone that's fitting into the top of the tube. I'm going to take my extra shock cord line here and just stuff it down into the tube. And then I'll return to working with my parachute. Okay. So I've got all my shroud lines laid on top. This guy folded over. And the rest of the parachute rolled together into a nice little package like so. And then all of this inserted into the body tube, making sure that we're not pinching any portion of the lines or anything like that between the nose cone and the body tube. This should all fit nicely together. And then the entire rocket is almost ready for launch. We'll talk about motor insertion and prepping the rocket for flight. Now, while we've successfully assembled the rocket and we've managed to pack the parachute in the right way, the next thing that we should go through is talking about how to prepare the rocket for launch. This rocket, though it appears to be complete and ready for launch, is not actually. There are a few pieces that have to be added. First, we need to add a motor to our rocket. We need to correctly insert our recovery wadding to protect the parachute and the shroud lines from the heat of the ejection charge. And then once at our launch pad, we'll insert an igniter and an igniter plug, and then connect up our launch controllers, and the rocket at that point will be ready for launch. So what we have to do, unfortunately, is we're going to take our nose cone off and pull our parachute out. If I give a gentle tug here, there's my parachute and all of my shroud line. Okay, so the way that our rocket launch works is once the rocket is on the pad, we'll insert one of these pyrogel igniters into the end of the rocket. The igniter will be inserted into the end of the rocket at the nozzle end. You'll notice that there's a big empty gap here at the top end of the motor. That's not where the igniter goes. It goes into the end of the rocket motor here. We'll put a igniter plug in to hold the igniter in place, and that'll be fed into the bottom end of the rocket. The rocket will take off from the launch pad, and the engine will burn all the way through all of its propellant, and there will be a coast phase during which there's a small amount of smoke charge that is burned in order for the rocket to be more visible in the sky. At the end of that coast phase, the ejection charge, the very top of the rocket motor, ignites and explodes and blows the clay cap off of the top end of the rocket motor and fills the body with hot ejection charge gases. This overpressurizes the rocket body and forces the rocket to come apart. It pushes the nose cone off and forces the parachute out, and the rocket is able to descend to the ground. But as part of this process, when that rocket fills with all of those hot gases, we need to have a way to protect the delicate parachute and shroud lines from the hot ejection gases, and that is what these pieces of recovery wadding are for. They are flame-resistant bits of tissue that we will insert into the body tube in such a way that we actually do have to stuff these down a little bit. It's best if they form a nice solid wall against the ejection charges and keep the delicate parachute and shroud lines safe from those hot gases. So we take three of those pieces of recovery wadding and stuff them down into the body tube. Then we can follow that with our shroud line, our parachute, and then the nose cone, just as we saw earlier in the video. And that part of the rocket's launch prep will be complete. Moving on to the end here, if you'll forgive me and pretend that we have actually inserted our parachute and nose cone, the way our rocket motor goes into the motor mount tube and the retention clip, sorry, I do have puppies here, is we force the motor mount clip out of the way with the motor itself and insert that into our motor mount tube, again making sure that our clay nozzle end is sticking out of the rocket, and this should slide enough into our motor mount tube that the clip fits over the end of it. It should fit just enough that the clip is able to settle in place. The front end of this motor is now pressed against the front end of the motor retention clip, that little metal piece that sticks through the motor retention or the motor mount tube. So the motor is now secure here, and when the ejection charge fires, that clip is going to make sure that the motor cannot kick itself out of the rocket. So it's important to make sure that the clip is actually over the end of the motor here. If you find that your motor clip still sticks off the edge of the rocket's motor and does not actually settle in place over the motor, then remove your motor, pull your clip down towards the center line of the rocket enough so that it will spring back into this position where it's going to clasp over the end of the motor, and you can try inserting that motor again, and that clip should be fit right over the cardboard side of the sidewall of the motor itself. Out at the launch pad is when we would insert our motor, insert our pyrogel igniter. You will find that as you insert that igniter, it's going to bottom out right against the propellant inside the motor. These motors are solid propellant, so you'll feel the pyrogel igniter bottom out against that propellant. And then you can take this igniter and bend the wires so that now that pyrogel is touching the propellant and we've bent our igniter wires over. At the same time, we're going to grab one of our igniter plugs and inserting this guy back in here. I'm going to take the plug and press it so that it holds the igniter's pyrogel tip against the propellant and keeps the igniter from falling out while we're at the launch pad. I'll take the two ends of the igniter wires and I'll separate them from each other just slightly. We're passing out rocket kits to all of the participants in the rocketry program, but we only have two launch pads for the entire program, so nobody got a launch pad as part of their kit. However, if you're lucky enough to have a launch pad at home, you know that there are two alligator clips, one that clips onto each of these sides of the igniter, and that's what's going to pass our electric charge through the igniter, through the pyrogel tip, igniting it when we press that button on the launch controller. When that pyrogel tip ignites, it's also going to ignite the propellant inside the motor, and we all know what happens after that. The rocket takes right off of the pad. So this is how to properly prepare the rocket for the launch pad. We'd then be able to slide this down over our launch rod using our launch lug right here, clip on our alligator clips, and then retreat back about 15 feet away from the launch pad and do our countdown and press our launch controller button. Okay, so that concludes the rocket assembly. We'll hopefully all be able to get together sometime soon and actually launch the rockets together. I hope that day will come soon. But in the meantime, keep your rocket in a safe place up on a bookshelf where it's not going to get stepped on or knocked over. And we will hopefully see everybody soon.